storm. Residents on Florida's Gulf Coast faced a long, arduous process of cleanup, as well as decisions on how or if they will rebuild in the wake of Hurricane Ian. And under threat, indigenous tribes in Brazil confront existential challenges to their land and way of life as Brazilians decide whether to re-elect incumbent President Jair Bolsonaro.
When Bolsonaro was campaigning in the last elections, he already said he would not preserve even a centimeter, not even a millimeter of indigenous land, of our territories that were already being threatened.
All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
It was like an aha moment. This is what I love doing. Early stage companies have this energy that energizes me. These are people who are trying to change the world. When I volunteer with women entrepreneurs, it's the same thing. I'm helping people reach their dreams. I'm thriving by helping others every day. People who know BDO.
The Candida Fund, committed to advancing restorative justice and meaningful work through investments in transformative leaders and ideas. More at CandidaFund.org. Carnegie Corporation of New York. Supporting innovations in education, democratic engagement, and the advancement of international peace and security at carnegie.org. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
I'm Vanessa Ruiz in for Stephanie Tsai with NewsHour West. We'll return to the full program after the latest headlines. The U.S. economy is showing pockets of strength today, though there are many signs that still point to a broader slowdown. The Commerce Department reported the economy grew at a 2.6% annual rate from July through September, after having shrunk in the first half of the year. Exports accounted for much of the growth. President Biden hailed the progress at an event in upstate New York.
Economic growth is up. The price of inflation is down. Real incomes are up, and the price of gas is down. And the American people are seeing the benefits of this economy that works for them. Families have more net worth today than they did before the pandemic.
But the outlook is not all rosy. The economy is still grappling with a housing market slump and a decline in retail sales. In other economic news, U.S. jobless claims inched a little higher last week. The Labor Department today reported applications for unemployment benefits rose to 217,000. That is 3,000 more than the previous week. Despite the increase, overall jobless claims remain historically low. And breaking right now, Elon Musk has formally taken over Twitter. The Washington Post reports that Musk fired several top executives. The $44 billion deal closed late this evening. And meanwhile, overseas, the European Central Bank raised interest rates by 0.75% today to help curb rampant inflation. It matches a record increase last month and marks the fastest pace of rate hikes in the euro currency's history. The move mirrors similar efforts by the Federal Reserve to tackle soaring prices in the U.S. Ukraine's National Energy Agency says the main network of its central region's power grid has been damaged after intense Russian strikes. That has led to a 30% reduction in power generation capacity in and around Kyiv. Rolling power cuts have left the capital in the dark, but residents say they understand the need to conserve energy.
When there is war going on in the country, it is not a big deal if one has to go home early or walk in darkness and save power at home.
If it can in any way help Ukrainian defense forces, I am all for it.
Meanwhile, in Moscow today, Russia's President Vladimir Putin gave his annual speech at a conference of international policy experts. He blamed the West for Russian escalations of the war in Ukraine, but claimed Russia is open to dialogue.
World domination is what the so-called West bet on in its game. But that game is, without doubt, a dangerous, bloody, and I would say filthy one. I've always believed in the power of common sense, so I'm convinced that the West will eventually have to start a conversation on equal terms about our common future.
Putin also said that Moscow has no intention of using nuclear weapons in Ukraine. We'll have more on this later in the program. And meanwhile, the U.S. is announcing a plan to send an additional $275 million in military aid to Ukraine. The aid will largely go to restocking ammunition for weapon systems already in the country. A Tennessee man was sentenced to more than 7 years in prison for his role in the January 6 riot. Albuquerque Head dragged a Capitol Police officer into the mob and restrained him while others beat and tased him. The officer suffered a heart attack and brain injuries. It is the second longest sentence given to a rioter so far. And the U.S. Department of Agriculture announced $759 million in grants and loans to help rural communities access high-speed internet. The money will be divided up among 24 states. It's all part of a larger push for high-speed connectivity from last year's infrastructure law. So to come on the News Hour, Russia's nuclear threats and false claims about Ukrainian bombs hang over the ongoing war. Also, new scientific imaging allows experts to determine authenticity of art, including priceless Vermeers. And two stroke survivors give their brief but spectacular take on living with aphasia and much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
Old lingering lies about the 2020 election are posing new threats of political violence and voter intimidation in this year's midterms. Joining us now to discuss this is Mary McCord, director of the Institute for Constitutional Advocacy and Protection. She's also a former Justice Department prosecutor, and she's been advising local officials about how to protect their residents and the vote. Mary McCord, thank you very much for being with us. So tell us what you are seeing. You've been watching this in recent months. You've watched it build as we get closer to the election. What are you seeing, and how does it have seeds in what happened in 2020?
Well, it's the same disinformation about election fraud that was the fuel for the violence on January 6, 2021. It's that same disinformation today that is threatening political violence related to our elections. And, you know, by political violence, I don't just mean physical violence. I mean intimidation, voter intimidation, intimidation and threats and harassment against our election workers, aggressive recruitment of poll watchers from groups like the Proud Boys and Oath Keepers to be really a force for intimidation at the polls, and other types of really anti-democratic processes that are being driven, again, by this same disinformation and lies about the 2020 election.
So what are the, I mean, you've named some examples. Give us some specifics on what you most worry about could happen on election day.
So the thing that we're really, I think, the most worried about is just voters being intimidated from coming. So what we've already seen is efforts, and your viewers have probably seen this, and you, of, you know, people setting up cameras to videotape people as they're trying to drop their ballots in ballot boxes. We've seen some even going in military kits and with arms. And we've even heard of people questioning voters or suggesting that what they're doing by voting is illegal, particularly if they're maybe depositing a ballot of an elderly family member or friend. And contrary to what the disinformation out there, that is not a violation of federal law, and it's not a violation of most state laws. Yet the idea is to intimidate people into thinking they're doing something wrong so they won't show up. And this is a part of this decentralized, localized mm-hmm. effort. You know, there are organizations that are recruiting for it nationwide, but there's no single puppet master, so it's kind of harder to combat because it's coming up at this localized level.
But you're saying it's being organized now more at the ground, at the grassroots level.
At your jurisdiction, at your local polling place.
And how widespread is it? Do you have a handle on how many places this is happening?
So, you know, every day I get new information about sort of a new example, including some very troublesome information about instances in one county in Pennsylvania where even law enforcement deputy sheriffs are deploying and asking people about their qualifications to vote. I would say right now I'm seeing it more in swing states than others, and that makes sense because those who are seeking to really impact this election are focused on the swing states, and that's where they're recruiting these aggressive poll watchers and recruiting people to come out to ballot drop boxes.
So when you see that, I mean, is there a pattern to whom they're targeting or what kinds of locations?
We've seen both the targeting of voters by efforts at ballot drop boxes and outside early voting stations. And sometimes these are just signs, like misleading signs suggesting that this ballot box is under surveillance or, you know, harvesting ballots is unlawful, even though that's not even a term under law and it's not unlawful where that happened to take place. But we're also seeing targets against election workers and intimidation of election workers, which is why you've seen a lot of them actually, you know, get physical security around their offices. And we are worried, of course, that during the post-election period, while ballots are being tabulated, that there may be intimidation and harassment like we saw in 2020. But I don't want voters to feel intimidated from going, because right. I think, you know, by getting the word out there about this and how illegal it is, it's not protected by the First Amendment, it's not protected by the Second Amendment to be, you know, armed watching polling locations, that hopefully this will deter some of the bad actors from continuing to do what they're doing.
And so how are local officials pushing back?
Yeah, so, you know, on Monday I spoke to the U.S. Conference of Mayors and police chiefs along with former police chief Chuck Ramsey, and one of the things we're suggesting is, you know, be meeting right now, localized, your mayors, your police chiefs, sheriffs, voting rights groups, the party representatives, election officials, and make a plan for what's best in your community. In some places, that might be law enforcement coming to polls, but in other places, law enforcement at the polls would be even more intimidating. So you need to know what works in your particular community based on your residents and what their relationship is like with elected officials. But I also think it's very important coming out of that with that planning for elected officials at all levels of state and local and federal government to be making strong statements that voter intimidation will not be tolerated. Mm. It is criminal. It is in violation of federal law. It is in violation of state law. And prosecutions may occur because, you know, what we found in 2020 is that sort of threat and risk of prosecution is something that some of the groups that had been planning, you know, activities on Election Day changed those plans.
So it had some effect. Mm-hmm. And just quickly, Mary McCord, what about individuals? Is there something people should be on the lookout for?
Yeah, I think that to the extent that they're seeing efforts, whether it's signage, whether it's people following voters to their cars or taking pictures of their license plates, report that activity to your local election officials or to your district attorney, whoever you feel comfortable reporting it to.
All right. Really, really important to be following all this right now. Mary McCord, thank you.
Thank you for having me.
When Hurricane Ian hit the U.S., it was nearly a Category 5 storm and one of the strongest to ever make landfall in this country. In its aftermath, housing is an urgent problem, and hundreds of thousands of households have applied for federal assistance. But there are big challenges around rebuilding and questions about the wisdom of doing so along parts of the coast. William Brangham has our report from Fort Myers Beach, Florida.
1 month after Hurricane Ian ripped through southwest Florida, communities here face wildly different realities. Some streets and homes in Lee County appear mostly untouched. Others are unrecognizable. Mangled roadways, entire blocks filled with debris, homes ripped to pieces inside and out. The terrifying hours of Ian's landfall are still fresh on the minds of many, like Adela Garay and her son Christian.
So you jump out of the window and you're in the water. You're swimming.
Yeah.
Who live in the hard-hit, low-income, mostly Hispanic area of Harlem Heights, which is outside Fort Myers. Their family initially tried to ride out the storm, but the water inside began to rise, first to their ankles, then their knees, then up to their waists.
We started to swim back all the way to the park in the backyard right there.
You were swimming across your own yard?
Yeah.
They spent the night shivering in a small building in the park across the street. In the morning, when they came home, everything was ruined. All of your belongings are gone.
Yeah. I don't have nothing. I don't have house. I don't have car.
They don't have insurance either. The restaurant where Adela's husband worked for decades was destroyed by Ian. The family is staying with some friends for now, five to a bedroom, and another friend is helping with home repairs. But as for what comes next...
I don't know, maybe sleeping in the park, or I don't know.
I'm really sorry.
No good. I'm sorry. This is very problem for my house. I don't know when it's ready my house. I don't know.
Ian destroyed thousands of homes across the state, exacerbating what advocates say was an already dire housing crisis. Daniel Cruz is with Florida Rural Legal Services.
There's no affordable housing available. And when we say affordable housing, we're not talking about just helping individuals that need subsidized housing or public housing. I'm talking about affordable housing for the typical working class individual. You know, what would have been years back a difficult situation is becoming a catastrophe.
In Florida, the official death toll from Hurricane Ian stands at well over 100, the state's deadliest storm in almost a century. Hundreds of people remain in shelters, and thousands are still without power. Total damage estimates are in the tens of billions of dollars. On Fort Myers Beach, which is near ground zero of the storm, the calm waters of the Gulf stand in stark contrast to the apocalyptic scenes on shore. This island community of about 6,000 suffered a devastating blow from Ian. At least 14 of the people who died in the storm were on Fort Myers Beach. Even the larger modern structures took a punch.
So the, oh my the kitchen gosh. Was here.
But many smaller, older homes were pulverized. Like a guest
area. So your house stood here and here.
Right.
And where is it now?
I found a little bit, one section of a wall in a friend's house, most of the way down the block. Portions of it are two blocks down, almost in the bay. I imagine some of it is actually in the water because it was a complete washover.
Wait, so the water was this high?
Over our head by a few feet.
Oh my gosh.
Over your head.
Bill Veach lost almost his entire 90-year-old house to Ian. He and his wife have lived here for more than a decade, and 2 years ago, he was elected to the town council.
A lot of people are very upset. They think things should be happening much faster than they are. Personally, being involved in it, I am really amazed at how fast things are working. But I think that now is a very difficult time for people emotionally, because this is where people are finally trying to come to the realization of what's next. You know, do they rebuild? Do they have to move away?
Much further inland in Lee County, while the destruction isn't quite as severe, residents are still struggling with an uncertain future.
What's my next step here? I'm kind of on pins and needles as to what I need to do next.
84-year-old Charles Mattson lives in a North Fort Myers mobile home village. And like a lot of Floridians, he's made countless phone calls to his insurance company, but still hasn't had an adjuster visit.
Boy, it looks like the whole skin of your house came off.
Yeah.
The surface of his roof was shorn off by Ian's winds. He spent two nights in a shelter, but is now back at home.
Right now, I don't know what the costs are going to be, and that's frustrating. I would just like to get started so I could maybe contact some contractors or something to start getting repairs made. You know, I don't want to have a blue roof forever.
There's the physical loss, but Charles lost something far more dear right before Ian made landfall.
About three or four days before the hurricane, my wife passed away. She was sick for quite a while. I basically was taking care of her for about 15 months. She was in and out of the hospital. So it was not a good time.
Because of the storm, Charles spent more than a week not knowing what happened to his wife's remains.
Are you doing okay? Mm-hmm. I see they got a tarp on you finally.
Charles is visited a few times a week by Kathy McWhorter, a Meals on Wheels volunteer for the Fort Myers nonprofit Community Cooperative. Kathy says Charles is but one of many Floridians whose lives were shaken, damaged, or lost by the violence of this storm.
How's it going today?
Hanging in there?
People who are now left trying to pick up the pieces.
Lee County's lost all these people, but all those people are lives and families and co-workers and friends, and it's sad. But we will get through this. And there's a lot of people here to help, but it's not going to be a one and done because I've never seen anything like this in my life, ever.
Judy, the official death toll from Hurricane Ian sits at 118 lives lost. But many people here believe that through what are known as indirect deaths, that number will go much higher. Indirect deaths are people who died subsequent to the storm, like when the power was out and their oxygen monitor went down, or someone has a heart attack when they're clearing up debris. This has been increasingly looked at after recent disasters, and people think that once that number is truly known, that the death toll here could go easily into the thousands.
Well, just so hard to even think about that. So, William, we saw in your piece that elderly man struggling with his insurance company. That has to be an enormous headache for so many homeowners there.
It is a huge problem, and even though there is an army of insurance adjusters across the state, the demand is still so high that people are frustrated, like we saw from that gentleman. The bigger issue here is the issue of cost. Insurance rates in Florida are as expensive as they are anywhere in the country. And that's not just because of the storms that keep coming through here. It's also, according to the industry, because of fraud and of abuse in the system. The issue with insurance, though, is also there's a larger, more existential question here, which is, how do you insure people when you never know when the next storm is going to come? Climate change is going to keep coming. Sea levels are going to keep going up. How do you equitably insure people in places that are this vulnerable? I mean, the private insurance industry has looked at this market and said, thanks, but no thanks. That leaves largely the government. That's either the federal government or, here in Florida, the state government, running their own insurance programs. But those two programs are either in serious financial jeopardy or are heading for a financial cliff. And so it's just a very, very thorny public policy issue here.
And William, it raises another question, which is, given the price hikes that you've just described, given the inevitability of big storms in the future, is anybody there talking about not staying, about leaving Florida?
You know, Judy, we've asked everyone we've talked to that question, and to a person, doesn't matter if they lost a few shingles on their house or their entire house, nobody is leaving. I mean, people who love Florida, and that's what's keeping them around here. Again, the bigger question is, does it make sense for the government to be encouraging people and signaling to people that it's okay to stay here? I mean, every time these roads are cleaned and new power lines get strung up and new sewer systems are put in, that is the government saying, this is okay to live here, rebuild. And it's just a question, is as climate change intensifies and there is this potential steady parade of monster storms coming from the Gulf right over there, how do you allow that process to go forward? And I asked the local councilman who lives here, and his argument was that better building codes is the solution. And certainly there are houses here that took a direct hit and they survived, businesses and houses. They made it through the storm. The problem is that to build your house up high and to build it like a fortress costs a lot of money. And the problem then is
that the wealthy can afford to do that and can come here and build or stay here and build, whereas the poorer residents of this community cannot. And so that kind of progress fundamentally changes a community. And many researchers who study this whole process of how we build or not build in vulnerable areas say that this process, which is seemingly favoring wealthy people, is not a smart way to go about it. That we have to find a better way of figuring out how and where we allow people to live in vulnerable places. But Ian will contribute to that debate, but it's by no means going to be a settled issue.
Well, a lot of tough decisions to be made in the months and the years to come. William Brangham, reporting from Florida. Thank you, William.
Thanks, Judy.
Today, Russia's President Vladimir Putin claimed that he had no plans to use nuclear weapons in Ukraine, despite previous threats to do so and warnings about the possible detonation of a radiological device in Ukraine. His comments came as the U.S. Department of Defense released a set of major strategy documents that describe China as the United States' most comprehensive challenger, but Russia as an acute threat. Nick Schifrin reports.
In Moscow today, the leader with the world's largest nuclear arsenal warned of a turning point.
We stand at a historical frontier. Ahead is probably the most dangerous, unpredictable, and at the same time, most important decade since the end of World War II.
President Vladimir Putin spoke as Russia launched its annual nuclear exercises. He once again accused Ukraine of planning a dirty bomb attack on its own territory, but insisted Russia posed no nuclear threat.
We don't need a nuclear strike on Ukraine. There is no point, either military or political.
We are certainly concerned about escalation.
In Washington today, Defense Secretary Lloyd Austin warned Russia any nuclear attack on Ukraine would trigger consequences.
If this happened, we have been very clear from the very beginning that you would see a very significant response from the international community.
Austin unveiled what he called the department's North Star, the National Defense Strategy, as well as the Nuclear Posture Review and the Missile Defense Review. The National Defense Strategy calls Russia an acute threat, but China the most comprehensive and serious challenge to U.S. national security. The Nuclear Posture Review reiterates support for the multi-trillion dollar modernization of the U.S. nuclear triad, the ability to strike from the air, from land with intercontinental ballistic missiles, and from sea. But it canceled a nuclear-armed sea-launched cruise missile reinstituted by the Trump administration. It also rejects a promise made by candidate Biden.
There is no first-use doctrine that we should be pushing.
For years, Biden has believed the U.S. should abandon historic ambiguity and pledge not to use nuclear weapons first. But the Nuclear Posture Review says that would have created an unacceptable level of risk in light of the range of non-nuclear capabilities being developed and fielded by competitors. The review acknowledges Russia's battlefield nuclear weapons and warns that Russia could use these forces to try to win a war on its periphery or avoid defeat if it was in danger of losing a conventional war.
And joining me now is the Department of Defense's top policy official, Undersecretary of Defense for Policy, Colin Call. Colin, thank you very much. Welcome back to the NewsHour. Do these Russian nuclear threats that we've just went through change how the U.S. thinks of its nuclear policy and its defense of not only the U.S., but partners and allies?
Well, I think actually that a lot of the veiled and not so veiled threats that Vladimir Putin has made is a reminder that for many of our adversaries, the salience of nuclear weapons is going up, not going down. And so the Nuclear Posture Review, which we released today as part of a series of nested reviews under the National Defense Strategy, makes clear that nuclear weapons remain an essential aspect of U.S. national security, and they play a unique role in deterring the types of threats that we're hearing about.
The review says that the U.S. would only consider the use of nuclear weapons in extreme circumstances to defend the vital interests of the U.S., allies, and partners. Does that mean the U.S. would consider nuclear weapons if deterrence fails and Putin does launch a nuclear device of some sort in and around Ukraine?
Well, I'm not going to go into hypotheticals about if he does this, we'll do that. I'll just say, as a practical matter, we have stood by Ukraine. We provided them more than $18 billion in security assistance to defend their territory, their sovereignty, their independence. We will continue to do that.
As we noted, before he became president, Mr. Biden said he believed in no first use. Today's Nuclear Posture Review said that policy or the declaration that nuclear weapons' sole purpose is to deter would have produced an unacceptable risk. Why do you think that you were unable to convince allies to change U.S. nuclear policy?
The president still aspires for us to move to a place where the conditions are set, where the sole purpose of nuclear weapons is, solely to deter nuclear attack, as opposed to nuclear attacks and a narrow range of other strategic attacks. We just aren't in that world yet. And so the Nuclear Posture Review recognizes that. The president agrees with that assessment. But I think you also have to keep in mind that our allies and partners around the world that kind of fall under the U.S. nuclear umbrella worry about a whole host of strategic threats. And they see the U.S. nuclear commitment as fundamental to the extended deterrence commitment we've made to them. So they were also nervous about a move at this juncture, at a time when the salience of nuclear weapons for our competitors and rivals appears to be going up. They were particularly concerned about a move towards sole purpose. So we consulted our allies during the process of writing the Nuclear Posture Review, and we landed where we landed.
You are ending the nuclear sea launch cruise missile program that was restarted by the Trump administration. Secretary Austin said today there was already enough capability in the U.S. nuclear inventory, but wouldn't that have been another weapon that U.S. allies wanted for reassurance and also provided the U.S. Another capacity to deter?
The folks who emphasize the so-called slick 'em in, the sea launch cruise missile, really emphasize the need for kind of a low-yield nuclear weapon so that you can have various response options up the escalatory ladder. It was the judgment of the Nuclear Posture Review study that we already have sufficient low-yield capabilities. And keep in mind, the slick-em-in, this sea-launch cruise missile, would not deliver a capability until 2035, and it would cost tens of billions of dollars. And we just believe that the bang isn't worth the buck.
Russia is in the middle of its annual nuclear military exercises. The last time that Russia had large-scale exercises, they were cover for the invasion of Ukraine. Secretary Austin said today there was no sign that these exercises are cover, but do you have the confidence that you'd actually know?
Well, look, there's nothing that our intelligence community spends more time looking at than the prospect that an adversary might use nuclear weapons against the United States or our allies and partners. So we watch this like a hawk every single day, 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. We believe that any effort to kind of mask nuclear use inside a nuclear exercise is something that we would pick up. We don't have any indications that the Russians are planning that. We do not expect them to do that. It would be a grave mistake.
Despite the threat of escalation, Ukraine continues. I got back a few weeks ago. President Zelensky is clear he's not in the mood for any kind of talks with Vladimir Putin. The foreign minister, Dmytro Kuleba, told me that the best discussion table is the battlefield. Some 90% of Ukrainians now are calling for the re-seizure of Crimea, as well as the re-seizure of all the territory lost this year. Is the U.S. preparing for this war to extend past the one-year mark, and what are the implications of that?
Look, I think there's in all likelihood, this conflict will go on in one form or another. And I think, part of Vladimir Putin's theory of victory, frankly, is that he can wait us all out. And one of the things that we've made clear consistently is he's not going to be able to wait us out, that we are resolved to continue supporting Ukraine for the long haul.
And do you believe the U.S. can maintain the political support you've had in the past and also have enough military materiel on the shelf or for the long term to support Ukraine in a war again that seems like it's going to go on for a long time?
You know, I think there's considerable bipartisan support for Ukraine. I mean, periodically you hear comments in one direction or the other, but frankly, I think there's considerable support. I think the American people support the effort. I think that despite high energy costs and a cold winter approaching in Europe, that we're going to keep the alliance unified. So I think we can and that we will continue to support Ukraine.
Colin Kahl, Undersecretary of Defense for Policy, thank you very much.
Thanks, Nick.
This weekend, millions of Brazilians will go to the polls to vote in the final round of the presidential election, which pits right-wing incumbent Jair Bolsonaro against former two-time president Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva. That election could have huge consequences for the Amazon rainforest and for the indigenous people who live there. NewsHour special correspondent Jane Ferguson traveled into the Amazon for this story, produced in partnership with the Pulitzer Center.
It's an indigenous version of the Olympics in the Amazon, complete with opening ceremony. Here, every 4 years, 13 different indigenous communities gather as young people compete at age-old traditions, running races, bow and arrow, swimming, tug of war. Above all, these youth games are an effort to keep their cultures alive, at a time when those cultures are under fierce attack, says the local community leader, Abrau Atman.
Our culture is being assassinated by white culture. The games really come to the rescue, so it's of the utmost importance, because the younger generation begin to understand themselves. They see all these people here together. It serves as a kind of appreciation for our culture.
We were invited to witness the event and traveled to a tip of land where the Tapajós and Amazon rivers nearly meet, in an indigenous community known as Vila Franca. Communities like this are fighting to stay on their land.
We are at war with the Brazilian government.
Oracelia Arapiun has been struggling for the rights of her community for years, and never as hard, she says, as during the years since President Jair Bolsonaro took office in 2019.
When Bolsonaro was campaigning in the last elections, he already said he would not preserve even a centimeter, not even a millimeter of indigenous land, of our territories that were already being threatened.
Territory designated for indigenous communities is meant to be protected from industries such as mining, which is highly pollutive, or forest clearing to grow crops like soy or graze cattle. Right-wing populist president Jair Bolsonaro counts those agribusinesses as his loyalists. To get elected, he campaigned to develop untouched land in the Amazon, and he continues to do so. One of his first acts as president was taking the federal bodies in charge of indigenous rights and forest conservation and moving them from the Justice Ministry to the Agriculture Ministry.
We don't sell our land because it is like our mother. Our territory is our body. And we don't sell our body, we don't sell our mother. We wouldn't sell it because it is sacred. And we start suffering pressures of invasion, pressure from mining, from agribusiness, which has expanded a lot, pressure from logging companies, which are deforesting our territories, and we have been resisting.
As Bolsonaro faces former President Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva, known widely as Lula, in a runoff for re-election, the Amazon rainforest and its people have become part of a wider political battle. Development versus conservation, job creation versus indigenous rights. Humanities professor Felipe Milanese says this is all part of a political playbook with messaging by Bolsonaro that stokes fears like...
So we don't have money today. The economy in Brazil is broke because of international support to indigenous people. And Bolsonaro appeals to that, to, let's say, middle class. That's why you don't have job, because you don't have the economy running, because indigenous people doesn't allow us to extract the rich of the nation.
In June, British journalist Dom Phillips and indigenous conservation activist Bruno Parreira were murdered in the Amazon while investigating illegal fishing. President Bolsonaro's response was unsympathetic.
Two people on a boat in a completely wild region is an adventure that is not recommended to do.
Anything can happen. It could be an accident. It could be that they were executed.
Environmentalists in Brazil, many of them indigenous, have seen an uptick in brutal murders in recent years. Activists blame the government for, at best, not cracking down on the violence, and at worst, condoning it.
There's a war against the environment, and there's a war against indigenous people. It's public-private partnership, because the state supports the killing. Or at least the Brazilian state allows the killing to be made, or it's very often it's a policeman that's it's doing the killing as a freelance job, for example.
Further down the Tapajós River, we meet with Alessandra Munduruku, who continues to fight agribusinesses encroaching on her people's land. She showed us what her community is up against: growing industrial development. On the Tapajós, Itaituba Port is a hub for much of the soy grown upriver in areas cleared deeper in the forest. That soy passes through here en route to such faraway states as Mato Grosso and Bahia.
That's a new port there?
Yeah, outro port.
So they're just expanding all the way down here?
It is a governmental project, and who gets in the way a lot, who disturbs, they say these indigenous have to move. They have to be put somewhere. They are not to be here. And there is no space for us.
Munduruku doesn't feel safe to stay for more than a short time. She is known here and abroad for her indigenous activism.
So we were just filming here outside the port, and some of the men standing on the port on the industrial side started filming us, filming them, and making calls. So we're going to move a little bit further up the river.
All along the river's banks, signs of development as the port grows. It is a logistics hub to transport grains out of the areas already cleared inside the rainforest. Even the mayor seems to be doing well in the current circumstances. This is his yacht. Since Bolsonaro came to power, illegal mining, logging, and development has boomed inside the Amazon under a culture of impunity and looking the other way.
A gente viu.
We saw companies trying to enter indigenous lands. We saw mining going further inside the territory. We started to see very strong fires, land grabbing in the territory, and threats. We started seeing our River Tapajós dirtier and dirtier.
Bolsonaro has defended his policies, arguing in the past that indigenous people have a right to prosper also from the development of the Amazon.
Felizmente.
Unfortunately, some people, both inside and outside Brazil, supported by NGOs, have stubbornly insisted on treating and keeping our Indians as if they are real cavemen. The indigenous people do not want to be poor, large landholders sitting on rich lands, especially sitting on the world's richest lands.
With so much money at stake, some members of the community have cooperated with developers, selling land and working within the mining and agricultural businesses.
Unfortunately, among our people, not only our people, but in other peoples in general, there is always a rotten apple. There is always someone who wants things only for themselves. Some who live in the city thought they could speak for our people in general. But the children need to speak. The women, the chiefs, the warriors.
Earlier this month, two indigenous women won election to Congress, Sonia Guajajara in Sao Paulo State and Celia Chacriabá in Minas Gerais. But Bolsonaro's party won the highest number of congressional seats. Their work ahead will be difficult.
These two women, they've always been from the movement. They have always been women who listen to us. Suddenly these women are there, sitting with a lot of people who are against us. It will be a challenge for them, but we will be here to always give them strength.
She will need plenty of strength herself. Munduruku doesn't advertise her movements and tends to travel last minute. But there's no denying she is completely exposed out here. These are risks she has made peace with.
I will continue this life. I will continue to defend my territory, my people, my children, sacred places. I will not stop now. Even if they kill me. And I am not scared. I always continue fighting and protecting.
You have two sons, so you've got children. You know, when you picture their future, what do you see? What do you hope for?
I always say, my sons, if today I am in this fight, If today there are these attacks, it is because I am defending what is best for you. Your future is the territory. Your future is the river. Your future is the forest.
Brazil's immediate political future will be decided on October 30th, when millions vote for their next president. That moment in political history and the impact it has will reach deep into the Amazon, along its waterways and through its forests, to the people fighting for both its future and theirs. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jane Ferguson in Itaituba, Brazil.
There's big news in the art world. A painting thought to be by Johannes Vermeer isn't a Vermeer after all. The 17th century Dutch master left behind few works, so take even one away and it's a big deal. Also a big deal, new technology allowing experts to see art in a different way and help make these judgments. Jeffrey Brown visited the National Gallery of Art in Washington, D.C. for our Arts and Culture series, Canvas.
The painting is called Girl with a Flute, and though there have been questions about it in the past, it's long hung in Washington's National Gallery of Art as one of the museum's four works by Johannes Vermeer. Now there are three, and Girl with a Flute is something else. Curator Alexandra Libby.
There's so many headlines. Vermeer is not a Vermeer. It's a fake. It's not fake.
Well, what is it? If it's not a Vermeer now, is it diminished? Is it a lesser painting?
No. Think it's closer. I think we're closer to Vermeer than ever when we look at this.
There are just around 35 paintings in the world definitively credited to Vermeer, an extraordinarily small number for such a renowned artist. He was the focus of a major forgery scandal in the 1940s. The exhibition shows two paintings that once hung in the gallery as authentic Vermeers. Pulling together a large group of the real ones, as the National Gallery did in a 1995 exhibition, is a big event in the art world, one that drew throngs. What makes a Vermeer a Vermeer? Libby points to the painting Woman Holding a Balance.
This extraordinary sense of stillness and tranquility. And when you look at a painting like this, this hidden light source, you know that the sun is coming in through this window, but he hides it. But it allows this light to fall so gently on her face.
Now the exhibition Vermeer's Secrets offers a different kind of portrait of the artist, below the surface, at the underpainting. Sometimes multiple layers of sketches, brushstrokes, and of course, the paint itself. And shows how ever more refined cameras, like those that do remote sensing of the earth and space, can peer underneath without damaging the paintings and find hidden images. How the angle of a pen was subtly shifted to impact the overall effect, or the head of an unknown man. Studying the images and chemical components allows scientists to create a kind of map that offers clues to how an artist worked.
We're trying to look at a fingerprint that's related to the material. And then in those maps, you can actually see the paint strokes.
John Delaney, the museum's senior imaging scientist, came to this work in 2007 from the aerospace industry. Now he builds cameras to look at art.
So we're in position, Kate. Then we can initiate the scan.
In the museum's lab, he and colleague Catherine Dooley demonstrated on a painting by another rather well-known Dutch artist, Rembrandt. A scan captured the work beneath the face we see on the canvas.
But already we can see this modeling and the buildup of the face, especially in the shadow area. Mm-hmm. The lit side of his face, of course, is bright. But over here we see the shadowing coming up. But a lot of these are not actually at the surface level. You can see it's very sharp.
Side-by-side images show the handling of paint and materials. And that's what we see with Vermeer in the exhibition.
It's a very different way of looking at a painting, clearly.
It is much more abstract, yes. But what you see is...
You turned Vermeer to an abstract painter.
In a way, I suppose. Some people say our images we make are very abstract. But you see the texture of the paint. That's the process, and that's what they wanted to know.
One key thing they, the curators, wanted to know is how Girl with a Flute compared to the other paintings. And it's the differences that emerged from these digital maps and images that led to the determination it's by a different artist.
Materialistically, it's right. The layering is right. It's the handling on the surface And what we're learning and what we're understanding from the curators is they also see it in the handling below and in the preparation of the paint.
The thing about all of this work is it's all interpretive.
Alexander Libby and her colleagues feel confident Girl with the Flute is not by Vermeer, but that it is close. Perhaps by someone who learned some of the master's techniques, but not all. Previously, Vermeer was thought to work alone. These findings could begin to change that.
You're thinking about who would have done this.
Yeah,
would
that I knew. What I hope is that museums will look anew at those follower of or imitator of, especially ones that they know our period, our 17th century, because maybe there are more. And then we can start to really understand how maybe Vermeer was teaching or who this artist may have been. There are more out there, I know it.
Oh, you do.
I feel it. I feel it.
And imaging expert John Delaney says the science is still evolving, and more museums are using it.
Wait 5 more years, and people will know a lot more about these artists. I think we're in a pretty exciting time period by pulling this all together.
Vermeer's Secrets is on exhibition through January 8th. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jeffrey Brown at the National Gallery of Art in Washington, D.C.
When is a Vermeer a Vermeer? It's a big question. And meantime, earlier today in The Hague in the Netherlands, climate activists targeted Vermeer's masterpiece, Girl with a Pearl Earring, with glue and liquid, the latest in a series of recent attacks. This video posted online showed one man pouring a can of red substance over another protester who appeared to attempt to glue his head to the glass-protected painting. Officials say that the painting was not damaged. After having life-changing strokes, Kate Kennedy and Alan Oliver found themselves diagnosed with aphasia, a disorder marked by a patient's inability to communicate clearly. They have had to relearn how to write, read, and speak, all alongside other aphasia patients at Boston University's Aphasia Resource Center. Here, they share their brief but spectacular take on how language is your life.
The thing about having a stroke is, like, I thought that I was strong, you know, I was fit, and then all of a sudden, like in a blink of an eye, a stroke.
Just like that.
Just like that.
Mm-hmm.
And you can't go back.
Mm-mm. When it was their stroke, I was 30. I'm a mom. I was full-time working because my career with specialty with strokes. I said to myself, like, what do you mean? Like, I helped people, but now I am a patient.
I woke up with a splitting headache. And so we went to the hospital and they said, yeah, you just had a stroke. You're thinking, like, I had a stroke, so what does that mean? All of a sudden, I couldn't find the words. And I know there were words somewhere,
mm-hmm.
in the ether somewhere.
Yeah. I was like a baby to a language.
Mm.
To say yes, no, what is your name?
Aphasia is the ability of not to able to communicate well.
Aphasia is very frustrating because your language, it's gone. You know it is.
Right.
You know what it is,
yes.
in your brain.
Right.
But putting out.
Right.
It's slow.
Yes. What happens with BU, all these people who have aphasia became a community?
It's kind of free.
Yes.
Because you guys, I'm like, oh, it's okay. It's going to mess up or really bad or whatever it is, doesn't matter.
Right, right.
You know?
Right. We're a group of people that we know to turn to.
Exactly. You know what I mean? I want to tell everybody what is aphasia, and I'm just me. I have 2 kids. They know why. My word's not perfect, but I I understand, and they understand me.
I can't go back to be who I am, but I'm here. I'm alive.
My name is Kate Kennedy.
My name is Alan Oliver.
And this is our brief but
spectacular
take on how
language is your life.
And Kate and Alan, thank you so much for sharing all of that with us. And you can watch more brief but spectacular videos online at pbs.org/newshour/brief. And that's the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Judy Woodruff. Join us online and again here tomorrow evening for all of us at the PBS NewsHour. Thank you. Please stay safe, and we'll see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by...
For 25 years, Consumer Cellular has been offering no-contract wireless plans designed to help people do more of what they like. Our U.S.-based customer service team can help find a plan that fits you. To learn more, visit consumercellular.tv.
The Ford Foundation, working with visionaries on the front lines of social change worldwide. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. And friends of the NewsHour, including Leonard and Norma Klorfine, and Koo and Patricia Ewan. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. And friends of the NewsHour. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
You're watching PBS.